Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. We're going to go ahead and get started to our second to final colloquium series of the semester. It's amazing. We're really flying at this point. I know it's beautiful. I know it's a busy time of term, so thanks for coming out. I know you won't be disappointed because this is a fantastic speaker and a really interesting topic. So as you guys know, we're lucky to be joined by Professor Ron Deibert from the University of Toronto, who runs a wonderful group called Citizen Lab now for a number of years, and Ron's going to tell us a little bit about that in a minute, so it's okay if you're not familiar. I will say up front that if you want to get some more information, 60 Minutes just did a great thing on Citizen Lab. What was it? A few weeks ago at this point. 2 weeks ago, right? So it was a really nice segment, so I'd encourage you guys to check that out. So Professor Deibert's in political science at the University of Toronto at the Monk School. But Citizen Lab itself, as you hear, is a really interdisciplinary faculty, right? Kind of a hub, a bit like the Ocean Workshop, you know, tries to be in terms of advancing various fields of governance research. Professor Deibert's published a huge range of articles, chapters, books. I can begin to talk about all of them here, but as well as a number of really influential reports in the realm of cybersecurity, and especially attributing cyber attacks in particular to, in this case, different groups around the world, as well as looking at things like censorship practices and autocratic regimes. So I think there'll be a lot of fun avenues for discussion. Today, Professor Deibert is going to be talking to us about his paper. I love the title, by the way. A Tale of Two Cyber Conflicts, Civil Society and Commercial Threat Reporting. Without further ado, I think we'll hear a little bit about Citizen Lab and about the paper. Yep. We'll open it up from there, okay?
Great. Well, yeah. Thank you for the invitation, Scott, and everyone for coming and reading the paper, and I really look forward to any comments you have. This is definitely in the spirit of the workshop. I think it's a draft, and we're going through iterations of editing on it, so it's a perfect opportunity to get feedback on any of the components. And quite coincidentally, as you know from reading the paper, it has this public goods aspect to it. So when I got the invitation, I was like, oh, of course, this makes perfect sense. So glad to come here. As Scott said, a few words about Citizen Lab. So Citizen Lab is a research lab. I'm the director. It's not a center or an institute. It's truly a professor's lab, but it's grown in size. So I've got about 20 full-time staff. These are researchers, and then also some students and postdocs and so on. But the core of the work is done by full-time researchers. We do work on digital security issues that arise out of human rights concerns. And I would say that the main signature of the Citizen Lab is our mixture of methods. So I'm an international relations guy by background, but the people who work at Citizen Lab come from different disciplines, and especially we leverage methods from computer science and engineering science to do the work that we do. The technical part is really at the heart of our reporting. We've been described as a kind of CSI of human rights, and I think that, I don't watch that show, but I think I get the reference. We're not an activist group or an advocacy group. We see ourselves as doing very careful evidence-based research in the public interest. And most of our reporting is actually just published directly on our blog post because there's a time sensitivity to the typical reporting that we do. But we also publish in conferences and peer-reviewed journals and so on. So for each of the streams of work that we engage in, that you see these public-facing reports coming out, there is an underlying rigor in terms of peer review going on. We have a number of different streams of work, and the paper focuses on or draws from the work that Citizen Lab has done on targeted espionage against civil society. So by way of background, in 2009, we were part of the team that published the very first public report on cyber espionage. So before the GhostNet report came out, there was nothing outside of the classified domain, and there really wasn't a threat intelligence industry to speak of. There was network defenses, but there wasn't a threat intelligence reporting kind of industry, and I think the GhostNet report helped spawn that industry. And ironically, here we are looking at it critically. So for those of you who don't know about that report, a little story maybe would be helpful. So we had received information from the office of the Dalai Lama and Tibetan organizations. They suspected their computers were being spied on. They had heard about us and our work, invited us to come to northern India, and we collected some network traffic samples, some data from their devices and started analyzing it back in Toronto. And what we discovered was that indeed they were thoroughly penetrated by operators in China, but the threat actors, the operators who were undertaking this espionage, made a very careless mistake. They had left a directory that we were able to find simply by Googling a string of characters in the network traffic. It took us to this website that was not password protected, that was a meticulous categorization of all of the victims. So we could see the Dalai Lama's office and our own. We had infected our own computer, we could see that. But also hundreds of government agencies. So there were prime minister's offices, ministries of foreign affairs, etc. We published this report, actually it's almost exactly a decade ago. It was end of March 2009. It was A1 Sunday New York Times. Like, mm-hmm. It was a huge story. And we made a decision to call the report the GhostNet report. We gave it a name. And I think that was inadvertently we spawned this entire industry. So now, like, these companies that do the threat reporting, they have to give a name to whatever campaign it is. So you have Fancy Bear for the Russian, you know, Cozy Bear, etc. So we inadvertently created that whole practice. After we did the GhostNet report, we did a report trying to be more systematic called Communities at Risk, which is referenced in the paper. We enrolled 10 organizations, civil society organizations, in a study as research subjects. And over a four-year period, we interviewed them and we collected network traffic data and samples of malicious software they received so we could analyze them. And the main conclusion of that report was that the same threat actors, meaning essentially nation-state intelligence agencies, that we hear about targeting industry and government, were also targeting our research subjects. But these research subjects were not being reported on. There's a kind of problem here. So this is not, it was like 2014 we published that paper, and at the time I even wrote an op-ed where I used this language of market failure and collective action problem, that you have a lot of reporting in an industry emerging that's in the private sector that's doing this threat intelligence reporting and network defenses, but for them the obvious bias is that they're looking for clients that can pay, and that's the business model. And so what's happening is you're getting a kind of a biased sample or a truncated sample of the actually existing nature of cyber conflict. And what we see at Citizen Lab, since we're focused on civil society targeting, presents a much different picture, a really more troubling one. So that's where the original idea came in terms of adopting this public goods framework. I was fortunate to have a graduate student, Leonard Mashmeyer, who was interested in this topic, as well as my colleague John Lindsay, and so we started putting together the paper. I think it's pretty self-explanatory in terms of the theory and the approach, so I won't go into any of the details here, but I will just, you know, flip right to the end and say, in terms of the implications, I think this is not only analytically interesting, I think it has some pretty serious consequences for public policy and democracy. If you have this distorted picture of cyber conflict that everyone is relying on, that's actually driven by private interests and offering a distorted, truncated sample of what actually exists, you're leaving a big part of reality out, and that reality is pretty important because we're talking about civil society, which is at the heart of democracy. Meanwhile, globally speaking, there are some troubling contextual variables. So we're in the midst of a slide into authoritarianism worldwide. Authoritarian practices are spreading. Another area of research in the Citizen Lab has been to track the proliferation of commercial surveillance technologies, which we have found being widely abused by nation-state clients to target who they consider to be adversaries, which typically are civil society, not other nation states, not necessarily critical infrastructure. They're focused on who for them represents the most serious threat, opposition, human rights groups, journalists, etc. That's what the 60 Minutes episode was principally about, that period of work. So that's it in terms of a summary, and I really, again, I'm here to listen, take notes. I promised my co-authors that I would come back with lots of good suggestions on how to make this paper better and correct all the errors that are no doubt in there. So thank you.
This is fantastic. And just to clarify up front, the audience for this particular paper, do you have a target outlet in mind?
I think it would be an international relations journal, ISQ or international security, something like that.
Okay, fantastic. Okay. Yeah,
so
you want to kick us off?
I understand this is part of a broader project, and so feel free to push back and tell me that you address this somewhere differently. But I was a bit struck by the frame in that I think you're adopting a lot of the language of threat that's coming from the cybersecurity literature. Mm-hmm. And for me, I mean, this is just straight up state repression. And so I was in some ways missing that vocabulary, or that frame, or that language. I study contentious politics, and so this doesn't surprise me at all. Right? I mean, this is just covert repression, and we've been talking about this in various forms since, mm-hmm. In the U.S. since the monitoring of Black Panthers, right? So, mm-hmm. So why this frame, or is there a space for a different frame, or engaging with other literatures about why the state would repress domestic dissent?
For sure, and you're absolutely right. We don't get into that topic in depth, although I did mention it just now, which shows that I'm interested in. I've, in fact, published on this topic, so I have a couple of papers with Journal of Democracy that are directly on this point. Mm-hmm. I think it's an important element, but for us here, maybe a bit tangential, because we were wanting to zero in specifically on what should be a public good, the type of threat reporting that's being done, which is in everyone's interest to know, okay, what are the threats out there, who's behind them, where are they coming from, what are the motivations, what do they look like, and how can we protect ourselves? That's obviously in everyone's public interest, and you're absolutely right that there is a disturbing trend when it comes towards, despotic regimes, kleptocratic regimes that are using this to repress civil society. It really turns that conventional wisdom on its head that used to, like 20 years ago, people thought the internet and digital technologies would undermine authoritarianism. We're actually seeing the opposite happening now. So that it probably would be worthwhile for us to kind of weave it in somewhere, but I still think it's a separate kind of category than what we're talking about
here. Yeah, and by weave it in, I just, in some ways, was just reacting to the lack of engagement with even the term.
Okay.
Hmm. Right. So I think you could address my critique by just changing some of the language at some point.
Okay. Are there any citations in particular, or
So Christian Davenport's got a paper on covert repression from the Journal of Conflict Resolution in around 2005.
Okay.
And that talks about engagement with the Republic of New Africa, a spinoff of the Black Panthers.
Hmm.
But that's the covert repression article that I think of. I'll check out your Journal of Democracy articles, because I don't know too much on digital repression.
Yeah, that's what I've been writing. That's effectively what I've been writing about.
Well, just cite yourself. You'll be fine.
It's sometimes, these things are so apparent to you that you backdoor them to some degree, right? So I didn't actually, I was thinking more about the public goods argument at the core of the paper, as opposed to broader issues around who's being repressed by whom for what reasons, right? It's more about the threat.
And the reason I even raise it is when you say ISQ or international security, then it says to me, situated in the broader security language.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Right.
About those concerns.
That's great. Maybe that's going to your question, Dean. I'm not sure. And if you guys wouldn't mind maybe introducing yourselves as we go to.
I'm Dean Luke. I'm in the economics department, and I run the natural resource governance program here. So I haven't seen Francis Pajor cited for about 50 years, QJA paper on market failure. So that was a reminder. The problem we have is really the same problem with criminal reporting.
Mm.
And I think I'm guessing there's a big literature on this. So people don't have an incentive to fully provide information about criminal activity that could be in the neighborhood, whether it's petty, violent, or what have you.
Right.
So people don't report all criminal activity in your neighborhood. neighbors might want to know if there's someone in the neighborhood. And so, and there's been an institutional, that's well understood, so there's been an institutional response. You may want to encourage people to provide information that they might not otherwise provide, because you're getting this under provision of public information.
Yeah.
And so you might look at that literature a little bit. So
yeah, that's
really amazing that struck me here. I don't know what those criminal institutions have to know what those responses would be, but you certainly don't want to penalty. You know, so if people divulge some information, you don't want to make it costly for them if they reveal something else in the process or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that's a good plan. I think that's a good literature to link to. And so that's my main comment. You could, there's probably institutional responses that you might think. So I mean, witness protection is one thing that comes to mind. I don't know a lot about criminal, but that's something that everybody knows. So if you're going to come forth and bring some information, you put yourself in harm's way. So that's one reason firms don't want to do this potentially.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's a potentially nice thing to.
Yeah.
To link to.
Yeah.
And it may already be governed by some, maybe in the U.S. or Europe, where institutional rules are robust, there may be some things like this that encourage, maybe the intelligence agencies have some ways of getting information on the public reporter. Maybe there's mandatory reporting of some things. I don't know. But I mean, I think there's more you can do than just pointing out this bias.
Yeah.
That's the start.
That's really great. I agree 100%. In fact, one of my own concerns right now about the paper is we don't get into the institutional responses to this, and so I'll definitely look at that literature. Interestingly, there are some proposals floating around that resonate with what you're describing. So, for example, there's an initiative, Scott's aware of this, the Microsoft Cyber Peace Institute. So Microsoft's put a bunch of money into and they're supporting a number of initiatives to try to create a kind of global public good around cyber espionage attribution. And the idea is you'd have this NGO that would act as a clearinghouse for data. So intelligence agencies, private firms would put in data into this pool, researchers would go in, and this would solve a problem right now, which is that you have clear biases in the reporting, not just from the private sector, but from national and intelligence agencies. It's politicized.
Mm-hmm.
I have no idea whether this will work. I'm actually quite skeptical about it, but at least it's an institutional design.
Let me follow up. I think you might look at these universities as well. And they're notorious on the reporters because they want to maintain their reputation. I was in at the edge of a case at University of Arizona where we had an accountant at the university who embezzled $250,000.
Mm-hmm.
Should have been in jail. The university didn't even report it because it didn't look good for the university.
Yeah.
It wasn't good for the university. But that's something that, so that's, you know, right up, you know, this wasn't cybersecurity issues, but there may be other things like, you know, so organizations and even NGOs and other organizations besides firms are going to have incentives that are going to lead to various biases as well.
Yeah, that's true.
You
do a
and
case
so,
study with
the
RIN,
actually, and but they're likely to be different. Somehow, so you get a little more. You could get a little more rich analysis.
That's actually really interesting. Yeah.
Yeah.
Good point. Yeah. Real good.
Yeah. I know from even our own study subjects, let's call them, like broadly speaking, the sphere of humanitarian and human rights organizations.
Mm-hmm.
For the longest time, they did not want to report security incidents, in part because of, you know, there's an IT staff that doesn't want to be embarrassed, so they,
mm-hmm.
you know, actively
yeah.
work to. But then, more importantly, they don't want, and I've seen this from journalists, actually, in particular news organizations, I should say,
mm-hmm.
they don't want their sources or the people with whom they work. Like, let's say you work for a large human rights NGO, you have a distributed operation with workers who are in different countries dealing with highly sensitive topics.
Mm-hmm.
And so if there's a major breach in that, or they're targeted by somebody successfully, they're also putting all of these other people collaterally at risk.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't want to publicize that because it will make them look bad within their peer community and possibly even undermine their relationship with the funders.
Mm-hmm.
That's changing, though. The foundations that hold the purse strings, we've been advocating that they build digital security hygiene into their grant making so that organizations can't slough it off or ignore it.
Yeah.
And build it in from the ground up.
Cool.
And
I think Gustavo, you're next.
Okay.
Do you mind introducing yourself as well?
So I'm Gustavo Lorenz. I'm in the Econ department and also affiliated here in the awesome workshop. So it's I don't know much about cybersecurity, but I was trying to understand your paper from kind of an econ perspective. So first, I think it would be interesting to distinguish the normative from the positive part. So essentially, imagine that you shut down any collective action problem. Still true that the marginal benefit of protecting nuclear weapons is more than the marginal benefit of protecting, I don't know, industrial secrets, and it's higher than protecting the marginal benefit of whatever I'm doing in my computer, okay? So even if you shut down any collective action problem, still you are going to find this bias in the data, because let's say there is some cost for reporting. If the cost of reporting is not very high, well, it's does not change for different players. Essentially, only those with high marginal benefit will end up reporting. Okay, so I think the key issue here is would be saying, oh, okay, so there is here you have even more than that because of the collective action problem. So at the group, these people with relatively low marginal benefit from security, they could be better off, but they don't have any incentives to find. So there are some economies of scale in the provision of this thing. So it works as a public good. So there is a huge incentive of doing it at the collective level, but not at the individual level. So that's kind of one thing that I think it would be interesting to explore more in the paper.
That's really interesting.
And then the second thing, I was seeing the interaction from the point of view of the offenders, so those are trying to spy, exactly in the opposite connection. Instead of generating spillover, you're trying to spy on a government agency, and you generate spillovers on individuals, oh, then you go for the weakest link. You spy individuals to enter to the more juicy target, which are the government agencies, industrial secrets, or whatever. So essentially, that kind of externalities, from my perspective, is even kind of more interesting, or I would be more worried about that.
Interesting. Thank you very much. Appreciate that.
I just had a comment as well about, you know, BEP, right? So this is the vulnerabilities equities process, or basically how governments balance when to disclose vulnerabilities that they find back to vendors and when they stockpile them for kind of a rainy day, I think Stuxnet or something like that. And it seems to me that a really, you know, robust, however you would choose to enforce that BEP regime, that by default, you know, would ideally disclose back, you know, as close to 100% as possible of these vulnerabilities back, could be a way. You know, it's as you say, you know, you can't rely on states completely, but maybe by helping to push that norm out there, mm-hmm. maybe that's a first step in the direction of having states be more useful players in this space. And I just noticed that you didn't really grapple, and I understand why, very much with BEP in this paper, but I was curious how you saw those two debates kind of linking within this.
Yeah, that's interesting. I haven't, since you just brought it up, I haven't really thought about it in connection to this topic. I've seen it as a kind of standalone
thing,
and always within the context of concerns around governance of signals intelligence
in the
digital environment, because mm-hmm. you know we've moved now from evolved over time from when what those agencies did was pretty much compartmentalized, and it was like a spy versus spy game. So they're trying to crack each other's codes and listen in on mm-hmm. diplomatic communications that are largely segmented. But mm-hmm. now with Internet of Things that we've turned our lives inside out. And these agencies are monitoring everything now. And part of that involves hoarding knowledge of software mm-hmm. flaws, driving up the market, and so on. Mm-hmm. So there might be a way to work it into this paper, mm-hmm. at least a reference to it. I could see how that would be part of the institutional response to, you know, if we want to, you know, raise the bar,
mm-hmm.
the hygiene for mm-hmm. everyone equally, this is a way to ensure that.
Mm-hmm.
That
mm-hmm.
said, mm-hmm. as it stands now, I think there are only three governments in the world that actually even acknowledge that they have a policy.
Not exactly an emerging norm, right?
And you look at places like China and so on, where there's no way that there would be something like that.
No.
And in fact, they explicitly have as part of their cybersecurity laws mandated that companies must.
The opposite, right?
So they're building insecurity by design mm-hmm. in that context, which is pretty troubling.
That's a good paper title as well.
Yeah.
Insecurity by design.
So I'm like everybody else here. I'm not. A, I'm, you know, I'm not an expert in this, but I was thinking of Dean's comment on universities, and then I was thinking of large nonprofits, because I think they operate in much the same. Mm-hmm. So how much of a, I'll use the word, a lag time for a kind word, mm-hmm. delay tactic, in letting people know of cyber threats mm-hmm. that they've encountered? Because mm-hmm. I think universities and big nonprofits, they're not on the, they're not telling you right now what's happening. They're telling you what happened 3 years ago mm-hmm. because, well, it finally made a dent in us and we need to acknowledge it. And you know, if something happened last week, they're, you know, one, they're scrambling to figure out what happened mm-hmm. internally, and two, they don't want to be exposed as being stupid, dumb, whatever. Mm-hmm. And so, do you have a sense of some of the where you've tracked things of a lifetime?
Well, obviously, it varies extremely.
I assume it varies, but yeah. I assume there may be some. I'll use the word norm.
I think you hit the nail on the head in the way you describe it. And I say this both from my own research, but I wear a different hat at the university. I'm co-chairing the University of Toronto's Information Security Council that was recently set up to address principally these issues. So Canada's largest university, major research university, highly distributed, big medical school. Lots of sensitive information, sensitive research being done across campus, and no clear protocols across the university that are followed. Mm-hmm. And having seen now some of the breaches that have occurred, the serious nature of them, I can kind of understand why there is a lag time, because you're dealing with some pretty complicated issues. So there is no doubt a concern around being embarrassed or not wanting bad publicity. But underlying it are either more media issues around liabilities, around protection of personally identifiable information, around what do you disclose that could actually create more risk for you as an institution. So you don't want to be very specific maybe about a vulnerability in some system until it's fixed. So there are all sorts of issues around that. But there is, bottom line, a big capacity issue when it comes to civil society broadly understood. So, and universities maybe a bit different, but nonprofits for sure. If you think about cybersecurity affects everyone, but the risks are not evenly distributed, is how I describe it. A big financial institution, if they have a problem in this area, they can go out and hire one of these companies and pay $1 million, have them research, examine what the threat was, mitigate it, and set up network defenses. For most, the typical NGO that we're thinking of in this space, like a nonprofit that works on, I don't know, prisoners' rights or something like that, typically they don't have capacity. They lack the financial resources to go and hire one of these companies. They barely have somebody who can plug in the printer or get the projector working, let alone deal with advanced persistent threats coming from nation-state actors using, you know, billion-dollar technology. So there's a failure there in terms of how collectively we're addressing this issue. That's part of the motivation for the paper, was to try to figure out a way to communicate this to a scholarly audience in a way that makes sense.
So, two follow-up questions. One is the idea of this hierarchy and, the big financial institutions can figure out how to pay for it, but a whole bunch of other players can't.
Yeah.
And then related to that, an earlier question about where do you think you might publish this, is if you publish it, will those down in the hierarchy see it? And will it get their attention? Maybe they'll band together. I'm thinking of, for instance, I work in a very different area, urban forestry, and there's a network very clearly, United States, of 130 or 140 of the largest urban tree planting nonprofits. Mm-hmm. They meet once a year. They communicate. So they trade information back and forth, because they're each in their own city and they're not competing against each other.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I was trying to think about how does this get to people that might have a benefit rather than just another academic paper.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's
and a, I understand that's Citizen Lab is well beyond just another academic paper.
Yeah. Wow. Well, it's funny. I've had this angst for the last like 15 years that I wasn't doing enough academic service in a traditional sense, taking the amazing work that's being done at the lab and translating it for my particular academic crowd, which is international relations. I got kind of fed up with going to ISA. And, yeah, I don't have to worry about having peer-reviewed journal articles on my CV. I've had enough of that. I was really focused on this reporting that we were doing. It's really public interest and different audience. So this particular paper was an attempt to get back to the roots and communicate to the academic audience. I feel pretty confident that we're doing a good job communicating to the right people that we want to reach outside of academia right now. It's a major part of what we do. Our reports are routinely covered in the media, and you write op-eds, things like that. There's a certain there's a moment in time right now where I think collectively speaking, policymakers are beginning to understand that this is a problem that needs to be addressed, and even the threat intelligence firms are also beginning to understand that they're starting to think about pro bono. What pro bono support could they provide, for example? Mm-hmm. And we're advocating for that as well. But yeah, this was meant to communicate to academics in my field. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and
then
I think
Simon
was next,
and
then
we'll
go for it. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Cole. I'm a computer scientist from the computer science department. I'm a student, but I study mostly. I'm in cryptography, right? So I study mostly the theoretical part.
Okay.
But I can see how the way that cryptographers design a protocol, they often pick up the low-hanging fruit, which is the threat that has been reported, the threat that something popular, something normative, and the entire community is flooded with these protocols that are easy to deploy if you have billions of dollars.
Right.
It frustrates me because I also study anthropology and I work with NGOs, and I realize how lack of hardware and software and people they are. So I'm wondering how much do you think this bias is? How far do you think it goes within academia? Is this just like on an operational level, or it goes up in the people who do theoretical work as well?
Yeah, I definitely think it does. And that was, again, one of the motivations in writing this paper was the frustration of being a reviewer on journal submissions and looking at some of the ways in which in the international security or international relations field, cyber conflict was being addressed. So for the longest time, it wasn't part of the repertoire. You very rarely would see an article on this topic. But when the field started to emerge, I was troubled that most of the analysis was drawing from private sector reporting that I knew to be biased.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I it would be a frustrating thing to review an article and say, you know, you really can't rely on that for these reasons. So, again, I'm hoping in writing this paper that this gets that message across. I do think it goes up into the way in which people think about conflict.
So there's a cryptographer who writes about this, about the way in which the cryptography community goes toward responding to corporates rather than
the
privacy need. His name is Philip Rogerway from UC Davis.
Okay.
And he published about two papers that criticize cryptography,
that's
the politics
really
of cryptography, but then he got a lot of backlash.
Oh, yeah.
He even said that cryptographers should not receive funding from Department of Defense and all that.
Yeah,
it was highly controversial.
No,
but I love his papers. And
but
practically what he said is the focus, cryptographer focus is often on security and not privacy.
Yes,
because there's an interest from corporates on security more than privacy.
Yeah.
And it's not that one is easier to do or more easily defined, it's just that there has not been a lot of researchers in privacy because there's no money in protecting individuals who are marginalized.
Yeah, that makes complete sense. Yeah, I'll look that up. You probably know Bruce Schneier. Do you know?
Mm-hmm.
So he, not only is he a
fan of Citizen Lab, but he's been writing on this topic
and
as well.
And an Ostrom affiliate.
Is
it?
Yeah.
Yeah,
he's an Ostrom affiliate.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So he's been writing on this topic of, and the way he's thinking about it is technology in the public interest. There's a gap that's missing.
Mm-hmm.
It's the same basic theory here.
Mm-hmm.
He's talking about different language. So. But thank you for those suggestions.
Mm-hmm.
I'll look at
that. Yeah, I just wanted to follow up based on some of the comments from the room, because I clearly buy and understand your argument about the need to make some of this information, the public good nature of some of this information. So I didn't find that difficult to
mm-hmm.
you sold me on the argument very early on. But based on some of the other comments in the room, I wonder if one of the ways that you can kind of play up the paper is to make the threat to the NGO, about, to be more clear about the types of threats that NGOs are experiencing.
Okay.
So I buy very clearly that they are disadvantaged vis-a-vis larger corporate actors.
Mm-hmm.
But again, you're talking about all the things that went through my head that weren't technically written here, but and so maybe it would benefit by writing them down. I mean, I've worked with a number of NGOs that have incredibly sensitive information, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you talk about NGOs that report on things, I mean, human rights NGOs that report on torture or something like that are often keeping a database of people who have reported accusations of torture against the government
mm-hmm.
on their home computers, right?
Yeah.
And so that information, I mean, carries real cost to individuals in some ways more so than, you know, medical data at the Toronto hospitals.
Yes.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah,
yeah, I agree.
And so I think actually saying, I think it's,
making
you
it
and
clear.
I are both thinking the exact same thing, but it's not actually stated in the paper.
Yeah, again, I think it may be, as I said earlier, one of those things that's so apparent that we don't actually write it down and just assume that.
And it wasn't until I was hearing the other comments in the room that I was like, wait a minute, like this actually means death to me, right? Like this has a much.
We wrote the story off the top of Omar Abdulaziz to illustrate, because it was the most recent, and it's certainly the one that has attracted a lot of attention to our lab because of the connection to the murder of Khashoggi. But there's so many other illustrations like that we could talk about. I mean, generally speaking, the transformation around digital technologies, electronic media, and so on, for a lot of groups broadly in the developing world and in the human rights space, it's happened so quickly and they've had to adjust and there's so many contributing factors to their insecurity, you know, resource capacity. For example, we see it's very common for groups not to have software updates because they're using pirated software, right? They can't afford to get the licenses. So there are all these contributing variables that explain the gap in capacity. And meanwhile, they're being increasingly targeted. Not just targeted, but increasingly targeted as the world slides into authoritarianism, and the groups have highly sensitive information that is valuable to those autocrats, and they can get it now. In the old days, they'd have to, you know, break into an office, pry open the, you know, drawer or whatever. Now they can remotely, using very sophisticated surveillance technology sold by these companies, can get inside their devices and not only get access to this data, but enumerate all of their social networks and find out who
and
else.
And to me, the scary part, right, is that you can see that a file cabinet's been pried open.
Yes,
well,
right.
You
I mean, so that you can you report that, right, and you escalate it up, and then
the next
reports.
Morning, ideally, you see it as opposed
well, yeah,
to 2 years later.
Yeah,
and the
security cameras.
You know, Amnesty and Human Rights Watch in the 80s and 90s are filled with these things, right? So the government has broken in and stole these documents, right? And so then there's a much more immediate public outcry about that, and you've got real reputation costs that the governments then suffer. Whereas this wouldn't be the case at all.
So I've been, you may be interested to hear that, I've been working with some of the larger organizations over the last decade, like Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International for sure, on precisely this issue. So for, you know, first 5 years, it was very frustrating because you'd be speaking to people who in the IT security division, if it even existed, and they'd be very defensive naturally because they're being piled on with all sorts of requests and users not following protocol, so you can sympathize with them. So it took a while to proselytize with the higher level, you know, the management of those organizations to first of all address the issue, like this is a serious issue we need to address, and then start actually taking specific steps. So now we're at a point where just over like the last 5 years, they've really matured in this regard. So we actually work with Amnesty International's tech team pretty closely now. They've invested so much in this topic, they're actually doing research on it themselves now. So it's nice to see.
Yeah, you know, academics also have this problem all the time, right? So
it's
academics
huge.
Who are doing field work
yeah.
and then are trying to get their data.
Yeah.
And
we were talking about this.
That's
practice.
Right.
I mean, you can write an IRB protocol and get it approved at a university, but you can't actually secure your data in the field.
Yeah, it's.
We
yeah.
often, we frequently don't have the technical capacity to do that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. It's mm-hmm. it's frustrating to see for sure. I mean, academics are, you know, if you think about how often we click on attachments, share documents,
mm-hmm.
send around links, but also do sensitive research involving
mm-hmm.
human subjects. Like it's a bad combination.
It's a perfect storm, isn't it?
It's
yeah.
a perfect
That was actually
storm.
On my list of questions to ask you if you had just one or two bits of practical advice for the researchers, you know, in the room.
Absolutely.
They do this.
Yeah.
yeah. So I will return back to the paper, but just
okay.
while we're on the topic, if you have a few thoughts, I'm
well,
sure.
Well, we have a resource
mm-hmm.
Called Security Planner.
Okay.
Just securityplanner.org, I think is
mm-hmm.
the domain.
Okay, great. We can
send
that
and
out.
It's
yeah.
a basic kind of what we. I was frustrated because, in terms of this type
yeah.
of question, we get it a lot,
yeah.
and there are very few resources out there that aren't quickly dated.
Yeah.
So EFF, some other organizations
yep.
have really good guides, but
mm-hmm.
unless
mm-hmm.
someone tends to it,
right.
it can get out of date. And
yeah.
then furthermore, there's a problem in the. In the curriculum, let's call it, because
yeah.
there's a bias towards certain types of tools and technologies that
yeah.
not everyone may be comfortable with,
mm-hmm.
right? Unless you're an expert computer nerd,
yeah.
you know,
yeah, yeah.
you might not know what to do.
Yeah.
So we created Security Planner, and the idea is we have a peer community of some of like world's leading cryptographers, security
mm-hmm.
experts, Bruce Schneier's on board.
Excellent. Excellent.
And they review recommendations. And when you go to Security Planner, you're asked to answer a bunch of questions like what's your main concern, what type of system do you use, etc.
Mm-hmm.
And you're given a tailored set of recommendations
mm-hmm.
that are peer reviewed,
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Usually
mm-hmm.
like 10 or 11. And
this
they're basic things that everyone can do
yeah.
to increase their digital.
Not
body.
Just civil society. This could be
Not
for
just,
anybody.
It's,
yeah, yeah,
it's
yeah.
for your.
It's
yeah.
a, actually a really cool tool.
Yeah,
no,
this is great.
So
yeah.
I'm kind of facilitating the primer for CISSP students on
okay.
campus, like people studying for the CISSP exam.
You're doing a lot, Rachel, not just that.
Yeah, that's one of the hats I
yeah.
wear, though.
Okay.
And it's cool that all the free tools that it points
okay.
out.
Yeah. Oh, good.
And then everything from the online tools to something as simple as like a privacy screen, or
mm-hmm.
that's
yeah.
also mentioned on it. So it's kind of a cool thing, and I like the fact that it's. I could ask my brother to do it, who's just an undergrad at Purdue University.
Oh, yeah.
You know, just to kind of be more secure.
That's really
so
great
it's
to
a,
hear.
It's a really cool tool, I think.
Thank you.
The word's
yeah.
getting
So, you know, it's not a tool that's dedicated to any one particular category of people, but,
mm-hmm.
you know, researchers who travel
mm-hmm.
and do research in, like, say, zones of conflict
mm-hmm.
have special requirements. And
yep.
this is why, also, I did an initiative along with Leonie Tanzi. Cancer at ISA for the last couple of years, we've held these sessions to just have questions answered for academics about
mm-hmm.
digital security practices.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And hopefully that spreads the word a bit.
Then I have one more question as well, as the other people are thinking. But looking at the kind of implications and suggestions part of your paper at the
yeah.
end, I had one, and spend a few minutes poking holes in it, though, okay?
Okay.
So one of the kind of classic rejoinders after a big cyber attack on a sector is to stand up, you know, an ISAC, right?
Yeah.
So after the Target breach, we had the retail ISAC. After
yeah.
Chrysler, we had the auto ISAC. And it just strikes me that, and it's probably too diffuse to work, but with something like a civil society,
yeah.
you know, ISAC,
yeah.
you know, that could diffuse information like Security Planner a bit more readily,
yeah.
maybe there'd be a few big NGOs like Amnesty otherwise who could form kind of like, you know, important components and cogs in that system, you
yeah.
know, but then there'd be a lot of other NGOs that could be a part of it as well and kind of feed off of those insights.
Yeah.
I don't know. Would something like that be beneficial, or is that already kind of happening organically without the need for some other structure imposed?
It's in the air.
Yeah.
I would say.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I've been
yeah.
advocating for something like
oh, cool.
that for
okay,
a while myself.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
I was surprised to see just last week, in fact,
yeah.
someone pointed out to me that there is a website
mm.
something called NGO ISAC.
Oh, is there?
Yeah.
Oh, well, there
so,
you go. Interesting.
But I don't know exactly who's behind it. That's why I was kind of surprised.
Yeah.
I thought, well,
yeah.
We haven't heard about this. It's kind of weird.
Yeah. No,
and,
right.
And there's definitely discussion among like different sectors of civil society.
And it's just US based, it says on their on
yeah.
the side here for the NGO ISAC.
And
so like ICRC, I went to, they had a big conference on this topic, and they're really wanting to develop some kind of protocol for information sharing around humanitarian organizations. You see the same kind of problems coming up and conversations repeating themselves, which is a good thing. You know, everyone's kind of recognizing this is a major global public policy problem has to be addressed in some way. So it's a matter of what is the right design. We've been working actually with the Tibetans in northern India since the 2009 GhostNet report, and have they now have a Tibetan CERT, the Computer Emergency Response Team, that works for the Tibetan community, which I think is really
awesome.
So you want a mixture of these things.
Oh, absolutely, all the way up to like, you know, joint operations, like the financial services as the joint, you know, security operations center. So, you know, maybe you see something like that for NGOs as well.
The difference here, I think, is that in a lot of the industry-specific ISACs, there is, there has to be a kind of fluency with law enforcement and intelligence on the cyber threat indicator side, whereas this, you could see that will immediately present problems.
It sure
right?
will.
So how you deal with that is tough. Not sure.
One other one I had was just there's such a huge range of cyber threats, you know, that NGOs face, right? So all the way from, you know, spear phishing campaigns, all the way, you know, to ransomware, you name it. And I'm kind of just wondering, would there be some type of triage system that you would look at in the model that you're kind of proposing here? Would you go after, and for that matter, that kind of dovetails how you make decisions at Citizen Lab about which, you know, threats to focus on. How does that work? I mean, there's you could get lost in the weeds every day with whatever the newest, shiniest thing is.
So what we've seen, and we mentioned this in the report, is that the targeting of civil society takes advantage of their typical insecurity. And so you see a lot of cheap, low level in terms of sophistication attacks succeeding, you know, basic spear phishing attacks. And let's face it, you know, the Russian penetration of the DNC, specifically Podesta's email, was not like a fancy, sophisticated operation.
Right. No, exactly.
It was basically however much it cost to Photoshop up a fake Gmail login page, right? And had he...
And the history of the free world has changed.
Had he had two-factor authentication, history might have been different, right? But he didn't. So that we see that all the time. And but that, the flip side to that is, well, that could be taken care of. Like if we could encourage the main platform providers to have two-factor authentication, real two-factor authentication, meaning like not on a cell phone, but authenticator as a default, it would eliminate like a huge swath of attacks that we're seeing in civil society, right? But of course, that's something that needs to be advocated for. With our selection, we tend to focus on we ourselves have a bias to some degree in that we are also focusing on these high-level sophisticated threats involving the commercial spyware industry. This is a major element of what we do, in part because it is so lethal in terms of its potential consequences. As Sandy said, you know, if someone gets inside your device using sophisticated spyware, it's not likely even a very well-resourced industry expert could, you know, we aren't able in some cases to determine whether there's actually malware or not on the device, because it's designed by like the best Israeli spies who've been doing this very well-resourced state. They can extract the malware silently without any trace of evidence. So we have to work around that problem. And that's why we dedicate a lot of our own research to tracking the proliferation of this technology.
Absolutely. Cool. Other questions for Ron? I hate to just monopolize. There's so many cool ways to take. I mean, so a big piece of this is obviously protecting, you know, human rights as well. And I'm just, I mean, talk about triage again. So I'm reminded of the whole debate around the right to privacy in the digital age, you know, a couple of years ago, and how, you know, for it's one thing to have recognized these emerging norms, but enforcing them is another. And I think that debate about international human rights and cybersecurity is pretty divorced from one another, usually, in the international community, including in discussions around norms at the G7, even at the UN at this point. And I'm wondering, what role do you see by NGOs and by groups like Citizen Lab? What role do they have in helping to, you know, bring those worlds closer together, right? Because I remember the climate negotiations, there's thousands of NGOs there, right, influencing the conversation. I don't see that as much in the cybersecurity negotiations, It's pretty state-centric.
Definitely. Yeah. That's certainly been something I've noticed for the last 20 years, and it was something I've been trying to correct myself to the extent I can.
Mm-hmm.
So to give you an example, back in 2010, after our GhostNet report came out, we were in a pretty unique position because it was so widely covered in the media and seen as credible by people in the human rights space. Mm-hmm. You know, they read about, Dalai Lama and human rights organizations being hacked. But then people in the, you know, in the hardcore intelligence national security side were like, oh my God, what is this report? Is like exposing all of this espionage in an empirical manner. Like this has never been done. So we found ourselves straddling those two communities, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized they're not talking to each other. They're not even using the same language. It's completely different. You have the cybers, you know, over here.
Yeah.
Than, digital rights over here.
Mm-hmm.
So I started organizing a series of dialogues called the Cyber Dialogue at the University of Toronto from 2010 to 2014.
Was
meant to bring together in conversation people from private sector, government, and civil society. And it was really interesting and a unique opportunity. Obviously, it had limited impact, I would say, in terms of changing, you know, deeply entrenched discourse and paradigms around and institutions that are driving all of this. That the reality is, cyber is part of a, you know, a national security enterprise, and there's a huge amount of momentum behind how it's framed and what goes into it.
That's
relative to the alternative paradigm, which I've written about, human-centric approach to cybersecurity. I just published with Ethics and International Affairs Journal. It doesn't have the same purchase.
Yeah.
Right? It's just not enough investment in it. And for that to change would require, you know, pretty wholesale changes in institutions that structure society and economics. And all of this.
Absolutely.
Yeah, Dave.
Is the Citizen Lab supporting PhD research on dissertations on these kind of data reporting issues? You talk about that would seem to be a follow-up to what you've got going here. I mean, I can imagine more sophisticated econometric statistics to examine some of these things. Is that something that's on the agenda with some of the students at the
field?
Right? Yeah, I would hope to do more of that. Up until now, my own energy was focused on trying to encourage those with skills in computer science and engineering science to recognize that their methods could be applied to exploring what are effectively political questions.
Mm-hmm.
And they weren't doing that. They weren't realizing that, if I reverse engineer this software, I can find out what censorship and surveillance is going on that's being mandated in China, for example. And so for like 10 years, I've been really proselytizing in those disciplines. And in fact, most of my PhD students have been from those disciplines.
Mm-hmm.
And lately I've been trying to change that and encourage more political science and, you know, students from other disciplines, law and economics, to come and see if the data that we're collecting at the Citizen Lab could be useful to them. As I mentioned, Leonard, who's the lead author on this paper, is my PhD student. I'm co-supervising him. I hope to do more. We have a lot of data, so if anyone's listening,
that's right.
Wants to apply.
No one's listening.
Right.
No one's listening.
Oh no, they're streaming. I just kind of on that point.
They are.
Yeah, right. Too many, maybe Big Brother's listening.
The Chinese and the Israelis.
At least,
right?
Yeah. Ostrom's now a target. Yeah.
if not there.
How many countries can you travel to at this point, Ron?
Gradually eliminating.
I would imagine. Yeah.
And maybe just as a kind of a final point that you can reflect on, and if you have any closing remarks too. I mean, it seems like part of the solution could be, you know, a global network of citizen lab type entities, at least in the countries that would feel that have the same traditions of academic freedom that are comfortable housing that. And I'm wondering, you know, what are the besides that, what are their hurdles to seeing that actually, you know, come about? Because as you say, you've been at this for almost 20 years, and so far, citizen lab is still pretty unique. And I'm just kind of wondering what else needs to change to change that fact.
I definitely see this as part of the solution in terms of institutional responses to this collective action problem. Should come from universities. And you're absolutely right that if there are more citizen labs doing this type of research, it would rectify to some degree the imbalance in reporting. And there's what we do is not rocket science. It's not proprietary. All the methods are transparent and reproducible. So I've been advocating for there to be more citizen labs. And the larger context here, philosophically speaking, I try to put it this way, that you know, it was out of the university that the internet was largely born, and now it's under threat. It's being seriously securitized, censorship, surveillance, all sorts of information warfare operations going on in and through the internet, which is our public sphere. And so the university has an obligation, speaking in the generic sense, right, as an institution, to solve these problems or try to solve them. And we have a lot of resources, academic freedom, ideally. So I hope that there would be more of that happening. And for that to happen, I and others have to field build, which is part of what I'm trying to do.
Yes. Easier said than done.
And there are some countries where it just won't fly, obviously. Like, you know, you couldn't have the type of research we do taking place in mainland China. Just everyone would be arrested immediately. And also, disciplines are conservative. So I hear from my colleagues in computer science and engineering science, work you do is amazing, but I don't want my students to work for you because it could jeopardize their job prospects. And you know, if their name shows up on a citizen lab report, maybe they aren't allowed to travel to China or work with this company or whatever. I've been sued. I mentioned this to you before. There's always legal threats around our research that cost the university. University probably expends tens of thousands of dollars just on our file when it comes to legal support. So that's a significant cost.
This is very hard. Well, we'll try to do something here at IU nonetheless. Yeah, we'll join the fight. But Ron, thank you so much. This
My
has been fantastic. Have a round of applause.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I know we all look forward to following your work. And,
Thanks very much.
And enjoy the rest of the afternoon, guys. Remember, we do have one last colloquium after this, and next week it is Vanessa Perez, Liquid Business. That's going to be fun. All right.
She's
so
a,
enjoy
she's
the
a water law specialist.
Water law. There you go. There you go. Fantastic. Yeah. So enjoy the rest of the week, and we'll see you next.
Your call will be disconnected.